Vesperinas. I work at the CSIC, at the Institute of Material Science. And I was very surprised a few months ago when I received a letter from Professor Torrecillas inviting me to participate in this meeting honoring Professor Serafin Moya. I know Professor Moya since 15 years ago when we started work on industry. In Spain, a work of research and development in industry is prone to be not very successful. This particular one was not. I know that Professor Moya had other work with industry have been much more successful than this one. We neither were successful at that time with this discussion on investing in the stock market. It was 2000, and we were strongly invested in Nasdaq companies and related, and so it was not good. But after that, things were improving, especially in our relationship and discussions, and I can subscribe everything I hear yesterday of his enthusiasm and drive, pointing important questions, interesting questions, and also very excited about developments for the future. In addition, we had many, many other conversations in Granada Coast, where we, in the last year, coincide very often. And so, well, it's a pleasure, and that is a pleasure to be here, just celebrating this honoring meeting for him and to be with all of you. I chose this subject for my talk, and the theme, well, you saw the title, and it related to light. And the theme is something which is related with the manipulation and the information that we can get on matter with light at the scale of the nanometer. So we are talking about scales which are smaller than, say, 150, 100 nanometers, which are down that scale, which is, say, the average wavelength. Twice that amount is the average wavelength of light. And, of course, this involves to break the diffraction limit. You see, this is one of the big goals, and say the holy grail one of physics, of and optics in particular, because the resolved distance that we can get of matter when we observe an object is given by the wavelength times the focal distance of the apparatus that we are using divided by the aperture of the objective. This, which is in bracket, is usually called the numerical aperture of the system. And then I am going to talk about optomechanics at the nanoscale. I also will suggest things concerning MEMS. And in particular, I will just show an example of MEMS applied to connected with the metamaterial subject. But you can ask yourself, why light? What is interesting on light? Well, light is something which we dispose, we have at our disposal. It's something which is very easy to get and to control, especially after the great advantages in light sources of every kind. And also, it has a very important property. It's very little invasive in comparison with other ways in which you can manipulate or observe matter. We can start with the concept of optical tweezers developed by Askin in the 70s. Well, this is the development of the optical tweezer in which a particle is held in the focus of a beam, which constitutes what is called the laser trap. And this particle usually is attached to functionalize organic matter, and you can study things like, concerning biomolecules. You can also manipulate them and so on by attaching this thing to, different kind of organic of molecules of biological molecules. The interesting thing are some magnitudes of the optical forces which are involved in holding these objects by the radiation pressure of light, which is of this order of magnitude. And what is interesting that people don't often speak about is the acceleration that imprinted, which is even of 10 to 5 G's. For instance, if we create a certain interference pattern, here we have a light interference pattern in which the spots are in red, and then if we put particles and more particles, these particles tend to arrange to just where the light is more intense. This is a kind of multifunctional optical trap. And because of that, in the beginning of this century, people were thinking on the possibility of using light by just performing through spatial modulators a certain kind of interference patterns, and then manipulate light in order to arrange it going to spots of maximum intensity of this. This was something which is related what was called the optical binding, because the particles themselves are attracted to each other with a strength which oscillates like that by the action of the radiation pressure of light. And this was even subject to a patent by, for instance, by these people from the Ravlan Institute in Harvard. But in fact, after that, not much really happened with that. And I think that this is a kind of research which didn't advance. And now, people, for instance, like this group by this man in Southampton, the United Kingdom, are thinking of using light in order to ensemble structures like this one. These are metal structures which have the shape of a Malta cross that by the action of light are attached to a certain substrate and conform what now are considered a metamaterial structure. Well, metamaterial is a fashion word for composite material nowadays. Everything that now you build has a composite with a certain order of structure, you call it a metamaterial. And this, for instance, this structure has the possibility of just manipulating light, creating a certain anisotropy, or just to use it as polarimeters or different kind of filters for light. Now, more on more on using the light to create structures. For instance, this is something which Professor Moya knows. He also commented with me about this work, in which we can create, well, I will say materials, but these people call it metamaterials, with very special ultralight, ultra-stiff, or mechanical properties. What you have is that in your computer, you use a CAD procedure to create a certain model that you transduce through an optical system which is composed of a collection of ultraviolet LEDs, and then you project this on a certain resin, and then you construct a unit cell of a certain structure. Then, as you increase and you ensemble this in the resin, you are creating at different scale. You can see how you create a structure which has very, very special properties. This is a work which is a collaboration between Berkeley and MIT, and is an example of how a more realistic use of light to manipulate and create matter can be done. This is, well, in my opinion, this is rather a very revolutionary way of doing that. How do you create at that scale such structures? Well, you use a procedure of nanopatterning by micro or nano lithography. So this is a lithographic procedure. So this requires to focus light at scales which are as small as desirable. And this, of course, involves the breaking the resolution barrier. Now, I am going to make a digression, a small digression here, because I was asked in the last 2 weeks about the Nobel Prize in Chemistry, which is much related with what I am telling, and for instance, with for instance, this device and this technique. This Nobel Prize was given to a German of Romanian origin, Hell, and two Americans, Vesig and Marner. It was given in chemistry because they achieved to create and to show a technique in which you can access to matter at the nanometric scale, at the Sauvaillan scale. And how you are achieve that scale in by those techniques? Well, I point here three papers, two of which maybe are not those pointed by the Swedish Academy of Science, but are just at the background of the idea that led them to this technique. Two of them are of the 90s, and this one is almost just in the beginning of this century. In fact, Hell wrote a review paper which was premonitory in Science in 2007, in which he reviewed far-field optical nanoscopy. By the way, if you read, I say this for Spanish people, if you read in newspapers about the inventors of the nanoscopio doesn't exist. What exists is the nanoscopy technique. For instance, compared two of those main techniques. This is the one developed by Vesig, this by himself, and also independently by Marner, he compared it with a more conventional technique, which is confocal. Actually, everything is a combination of working with extremely high numerical aperture systems and illuminate samples with fluorescent factors, so that you can choose different fluorescent color emissions, and you can separate different molecules depending on to which wavelength they react and emit light. Then you can identify them. The science is very interesting. However, in my opinion, the technique is very technical. It's something very technical. But in the end, if you compare, for instance, with the resolution of confocal microscopy, you see that you get down even to below, you divide this almost by a third of that. What is behind these techniques are, say, what we will say conventional optical imaging. It's optical imaging in what opticians will call the far field. All the work of these people, in fact, this is the technique developed by Betsy. In fact, was obtained after a lot of work on near-field optical microscopy. Near-field optical microscopy is detecting the field emitted by the object just as a wavelength distances, and then getting the information that you are lost on propagation. In fact, I just showed here a collection of references which developed, in which you can find the development of the fundamentals which establish the limitations and also the scope of near field techniques. However, I must stress that this is a far field technique. However, the far field technique actually is based on analysis of resolution done on near field. I just pointed some of the reference. I like to, for instance, to point out this book because it is the first in which you see optics at the nanometer scale as early as 1995. These are the result of a conference of NATO that we organized in Madrid. And this reference is a very important one. These people actually are two of the main actors of investigating the limits and the scope of resolution in optical techniques. Actually, it's funny because this work is the PhD thesis of this guy under the supervision of this one. I would like to point out this professor, which, in my opinion, is behind all the knowledge, or most of the knowledge, that has led to many, many techniques. These two books that you know very well, especially this one that he wrote with Max Born. You see, in my opinion, this guy would deserve a Nobel Prize, but nowadays you don't get a Nobel Prize for ideas. I said some days ago when I was discussing about these things that in my opinion, many of the theoreticians that won a Nobel Prize especially in the first half of the 20th century, wouldn't get a Nobel Prize nowadays. Because you see, those nanoscopic techniques, what actually are just the summit of a mountain which has been built by many others. They were those that saw it, actual images, and that was impressed in what people see. But there is a lot of study behind that, and of ideas. And I will say that a pivotal actor of all these ideas is this man. In the same way, I don't understand, and many people don't understand, why Arthur Askin, the inventor of a technique which has been so relevant, even outside physics, didn't get the Nobel Prize. I don't know whether many of you know that is an anecdotic that the person, which is Steve Chu, who was a minister for science in the previous U.S. administration, got a Nobel Prize as the consequence that he saw it how to manipulate atoms. And I don't understand why one of his colleagues, for instance, Phillips from the National Institute of Standards of Technology, got a Nobel Prize for manipulating atoms, and Askin didn't get it, because actually Chu was under Askin in Bell Labs when Chu didn't know what was about using radiation pressure of light. And he learned everything with the ideas of Askin that was actually trying to manipulate atoms and particles with light. So, for instance, nano-tweezers. What can you do? Just a few examples of what can you do with nano-tweezers. You get a worm, and you want to understand how the neurons of the brain actually work. So what you try is to focus light in just a very, very tiny portion of the brain. Now, a person has trillions of neurons, but this kind of worm has only this amount. So what these people are doing is to focus light on the brain of this worm and seeing when they control what neurons they are exciting, how it responds, how it moves, how it reacts. Another example is, for instance, you build with biological matter a scaffold to which you attach stem cells, and then by a protein that induces migration of the stem cells, and using an optical tweezer in which you have your microparticle attached to the beam of light, and you study the process by which illuminating with light and the RIC influence on the migration of these cells, and then they expect to get information on how tissue regeneration of repair is performed by cells and how this is influenced by the presence of the environment. Another example are tractor beams. This is an idea of how can we pull matter by the action of light and a futuristic space station pulling shuttles out of them. But so far, the tractor beams that we know had recently been developed by using incident bezel beams, which are twisted beams, which inside with a certain dispersion direction, this is the beam of matter, so that when they illuminate particles, as you move to this side, they pull the particle. The radiation pressure has a very strange effect of pulling the matter. We are habituated to see radiation pressure as something that like wind pushes the object in the direction of incident. However, with this kind of beam and some kind of configuration in the particles, you can obtain pulling forces from the radiation pressure. This was developed just in 2011 and published by people from Hong Kong and from Singapore and Denmark, And it was funny because this idea was actually based on a theoretical development that we made in 1 year before. We were actually looking for those forces, but we didn't realize that what we had to do is to use the Bessel beam. Now, forces of vacuum. This is the vacuum according to quantum mechanics. So vacuum actually is not something which is completely empty. You have fluctuations of energy through the space occupied by vacuum whose average energy is half of the photon. This is a detail how physicists try to manipulate in the computer the vacuum. And what is the effect of vacuum that you have here about the Casimir force, the Casimir effect? Now, although it's something which was studied in 48, now it's all the rage, actually Casimir forces. What this man, well known also in low temperature physics, is a Dutch physicist, as you know, study was just the attraction force between two metallic plates, ideally should be two perfect reflectors, which are at a distance d between them. What happens is that when you reach vacuum temperature in the environment, you are in such a situation in which when you attract the plates together, when you put them together, there are more photons surrounding here than here, virtual photons. So that the energy here actually is negative energy. Casimir actually discussed this with Niels Bohr when first he was a theoretician and was considering this problem, and he didn't really understand it. And Bohr actually was very intuitive, and he pointed out that maybe it had to do with the vacuum. And the thing is that this force, which is this range for plates, which are several millimeters large, goes as the distance elevated to the fourth power. Now, this force also can be created between, it exists at zero energy between any kind of particles, and if you produce dipolar particles, small particles, this force can be as small as 10 to minus 24 newtons, and even 10 to minus 12, the optical tweezer force. This was later much studied and developed, and in fact, you have two ranges for these Casimir forces between particles. One, which goes the potential energy goes as 1 over t to the 6, which is the van der Waals force, the usual, what we know as the van der Waals force. And this force, in fact, is an electrostatic force. And however, when the distance between the particles is larger, it changes to this value, which is a really electromagnetic force in which you have the velocity of light into account. This force was first detected between the attraction of a sphere and a plate and by using a cantilever procedure with a photodiode. And this is the variation that was sustained, 10 to of the order of piconewtons between this sphere of this size as a plate of 1 centimeter. And you see how in this range the force is zero and grows exponentially, very as a power of 1 to the 5 as you approach this these things. Now, the Casimir force, people now think that is important everywhere. For instance, in the universe, we know that the Newton law doesn't work at in the big universe as we observe the movement of galaxies. We know that the hypothesis that has been put forward is the presence of what people call dark matter, matter that nobody knows what it is, but has gravity and influence on these objects. Now, I recommend you to read this book. In this book, you can find an interesting discussion on the use of Casimir force, which has nothing to do at the galaxy scale, to study Casimir forces in connection and also the interplay of these forces with the Newton law at atomic scales, at very small distances. And this is because they try to explain the universe by the only theory that so far joins relativity and quantum mechanics, which is string theory. And string theory predicts at those distances the universe has 11 dimensions. And the 11 dimension violates the Newton law as we know. And then they try to check Newton law between two nano objects at very, very small distance and see whether there are deviations from the 1 over r squared law. And in that situation, the Casimir force is going to act. So there are several projects in several places in the United States, also in Paris, led by Alain Aspect, in which they try to actually observe such deviations due to the interplay of the Casimir force with Newton law. This is an example of where we find Casimir effects in nature. This is a salamander. The salamander has two, which are the fingers, have paths which have almost a fractal structure. There are more details that reproduce in cells themselves at a smaller scale and so on. And in the end, you end up with a spatula structures which have this dimension, this is in 1 micron, by which they attach to any surface. And the reason is that there is a Casimir force between each of these spatulas, or this termination of the fingers with the surface. Doesn't matter which surface is it. And this is something which is known, and the inventor of graphene, one of the inventors of graphene game, in 2003 proposed, one of the proposed of a gecko as a ship. Because the force of this is extremely high and it's dry. Again, this month, Seludev has proposed illuminating certain structures like this kind of, again, he would call metamaterial, which is a diffraction grating made in a gold field whose unit cell has dimensions of the wider one is 300 nanometers with these holes. And then when you illuminate with light, that you obtain an adhesion force between the field and a surface, an arbitrary dielectric surface. Recently, the people from Harvard and MIT have proposed the use of these Casimir forces to create nano devices like this one. This is a kind of metallic cantilever that can operate under the effect of Casimir forces. And it's interesting that if we go again to the origin of this force, what we have to look is at the Planck energy that you obtain in vacuum between a particle and a certain surface, for example, let's say. And then you obtain this structure. This is the vacuum. This is actually the photon fluctuation that you obtain at zero temperature. If you look at the Planck energy follows this law. So what happens in vacuum is that at absolute zero, you have just the average energy of half a photon. Now, what my last PhD student realized studying this is that you can obtain this effect also optically. And now what we are proposing is an interplay of the photonic force with the Casimir force by creating the photonic force by light. In other words, we create, say, a Casimir force with light, because this, what you want to have, this condition of vacuum energy, is that this thing is very, very large. Usually you obtain at T0, but why don't obtain it at room temperature with optical frequencies? Well, this is something that occurs. And this was shown. And in fact, what you do in order to create such Casimir forces is just to make optics, and the thing is to use a random slab that you can create with, for instance, by a procedure like the one I showed with resins, by etching in resins, with a certain random structure which affects the amplitude and phase of the passing light, so that you can create light with a certain power spectrum, the one that you want, and a certain statistical correlation function, so that you can mimic the photonic force acting on a nearby particle with a Casimir force. Is actually the same. And what is the advantage of this? This is not a force that is given like the usual Casimir force. It's a Casimir force that you build, that you create at will. So these are some examples of developments that we have with this kind of inspection with light. And we can ask ourselves, what about the future? Well, in the future, as I said, always I expect to see a Nobel Prize in medicine because of medical imaging at the nanoscale someday. And in fact, I expect that even that information will not be an imaging information, but also a functional information, can tell us not only just the picture with detail, but can tell us also what those portions of the organs or molecules we are working with are doing. And because this is an audience very fond of music, and in particular, I know that Professor Moya is very, very, is a great fan of music, of good music, because music is not either popular or classical. Music is either good or bad. And I want, in connection with the future, to end this talk with a couple of musical references. And it's about the future. This is an example of what the future was seen in the Vienna of the end of 19th century. I put the example, there are many examples. I just chose Anton Bruckner. Anton Bruckner was the son of a school teacher in Anfield. It was a small village about 10 kilometers out of Linz in Austria. And he was a very, very shy man and very humble man. For instance, I like this cartoon in which the great Richard Wagner is greeting him in Bayreuth. And you see, always the attitude of Bruckner is very humble and very polite when he meets people. He was organist of, in his youth of St. Florian Monastery, which is about 4 kilometers out of his birth village. And this man, Edward Hanslick, which was a terrible, a terrific critic of music in Vienna, in the Vienna of the last, at the end of the 19th century. You see, in Vienna, in those times, you know that there were a big fight between Wagnerians and Brahmsians. Brahms was the composer which epitomizes the classical way of music, although Brahms himself was a revolutionary, as was later on acknowledged by Schoenberg. But Hanslick was a champion of Brahms, and then he convinced people to bring Bruckner from St. Florian to Vienna to teach at the Vienna Conservatory. Very soon, he became enemy of this man, because he was an admirer of Wagner. So much that his third symphony has a theme from the Tannhäuser opera by Wagner, and it's called the Wagnerian symphony of Bruckner. So he got very close with this man, and he said, well, the music of the future, because which was represented by Wagner, all his followers, among them Bruckner, had no future. Well, Bruckner nowadays is considered with Gustav Mahler as the constructor of the music of 20th century. And again, it is a big revolutionary of the music. There is a big change, actually, between the pre-romantic and romantic era and the music that this man did. This is an excerpt from his fifth symphony. In the finale of his fifth symphony is something that I recommend to listen. And the next and the end is Sergei Prokofiev. You see, while the Russians were trying to get rid of the Germans in 1944, Stalin brought a bunch of musicians to a retirement, to a campground, which was completely safe from the war. And they were playing tennis, composing, and everything. This is a picture that he made himself here. And he, among the other things he wrote during this period, was, again, another Fifth Symphony. I don't know why Fifth Symphonies in all composers' landmark works. And the same happens in Sergei Prokofiev. In fact, his last movement is the way to a radiant future. I think that he already was feeling that the Soviets were defeating the Germans and was trying to encourage the Soviet people. So I expect also a radiant future in all these techniques of getting access with light to matter, and in particular biological matter. Thank you.